the word of the Lord. Consecrate me now to thy service. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. And let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. I want to talk today about when you get tired doing good. When you get tired doing good. My brothers and sisters, among other things, being a Christian is about doing good. The problem is that doing good is not always easy. For that matter, living the Christian life is not always easy. Well, the truth is, it's seldom easy. And more of the truth is, it's never easy. Living the Christian life is never easy. It's easiest on Sunday. It's easiest when we are all gathered in the Spirit on the Lord's day. It's easiest when we are among others who share our faith and witness. It's Monday to Saturday. That's the problem. Are you with me this morning? It's even easy to use religious language and throw around religious phrases. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm blessed. It's easy to do that. Because the truth is that people in the world use our language more frequently than we do, and they don't even go to church. It is not Sunday morning that's the problem. The problem is when we leave here today, the problem is from Monday through Saturday, what then? It is in the daily activities of life that we are called upon to do good, and it is the devil who comes along and seeks to frustrate our lives and throw us off course and away from God's will. That's why you need to go to church every Sunday. Amen. To get back on track. Paul says it best when he writes to the Corinthian church, when I would do good, evil is always present. And again, he says, the good that I want to do, I do not. But the evil that I don't want to do, that I do. Let me put it another way. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do it anyway. The problem with doing good is that the devil doesn't want us to do good. And it's not just knowing what the good is, because you can know it and still not do it. Knowing what is wrong doesn't always keep us from doing wrong. Am I right? If it were just in the knowing, we would be perfect because we know. But it is somewhere between the knowing and the doing. Paul says that the very thing I don't want to do because I know it's wrong is what I wind up doing. Y'all act like you ain't been there and done that. What a terrible state to be in. What a quagmire. What a dilemma to know what is good, but something within or without keeps us from doing what we know we ought to do. Now, what makes doing good so difficult is that just because you do good does not mean that other folk are going to do the same. The dilemma is, how do you do good in a bad world? In a world where others are not doing good, where does a good person fit around bad folks? In a world that can take your goodness for weakness. Because some folk will take advantage. Anybody wake this morning? I say some folk will take advantage of your goodness, and they assume that because you're good, they can run all over you. And you know, there are some good people, there are some kind people who have the kindest heart. They're just good, but they're just good folk, and people will take advantage of them and run all over them because they take goodness for weakness. Some people will see your goodness as an opportunity to take advantage of you. But you know, there's a difference between doing good and being dumb. Can I say that? I ain't called nobody dumb. I said there's a difference in doing good and being dumb. and being naive. And the other thing is that some people do good for the wrong reasons and with the wrong motives. Some folk do good for the approval of others. Some people do good to be praised, and you gotta pet them, you gotta call their name and make sure you spell it right. Some people need to be praised. Some people do good in order to manipulate and get their way. Every child knows how to do good to get their way. They do good. Some people do good for a season, but the season don't last. As long as there's an advantage in doing good, they do good. But as soon as there is no longer an advantage, as soon as they find out they ain't gonna get nothing out of this, or there's nothing to gain, they revert to the old no good self. Because the truth is, you really can't do good without being good. The being comes before the doing. Let's see. Excuse this, but you is it before you do it. You is it. You is. I don't know how else to put it. Don't you? You is. You is who you is before you can do what you there's the isness. Lord have mercy. I don't know how I got in this thing here, but you is, you are. I don't care how you want to put it. You got to be it before you can do it. Otherwise, it ain't real. Right, that's right. The being becomes before the doing. If a refrigerator makes stuff cold, in other words, it does that because of what it is. Am I making sense? I think that's pretty good. That the refrigerator makes stuff cold because that's what it is. That is its isness. Its being is in making stuff cold, and therefore there's no conflict between the being and the doing. You can't do what you not are inside. You got to be it before you can do it. Otherwise, it's phony. If it ain't real, it just ain't real. And you know, folk know. Yes, they do. If it ain't real, if you in the church just performing, you know, for the glory and for the praise and to get folk going, you know how some folk to entertain, you know, and to get people on their feet. Folks know if it's not real, if it's phony. Folks know when we just play in church. And you know who really can see through us and know when we're phony? It's children.
That's right.
Am I right about that? They can see through that stuff. They'll tell you. Ain't no phoniness in them. You know, children learn how to be phony. That's what we learn, how to be hypocritical. We learn how to say what we really don't mean, because children are honest. They're so honest that it's scary. You know, a little kid comes up to me and said, "Why you do all that hollering?" And you know, most of the time an adult wouldn't say that to me. They might think it, but they wouldn't say it. But a child is brutally honest, and a child wants to know why, and you got to tell them something, because there's something about them they can see through it. Real goodness comes from your heart. It involves being good, not just doing good. And if you're doing it, but you're not being it, it ain't real. And so some folk come to church just to impress the rest of us that they're so good. Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, writes to the Christians in Galatia about what it means to do good. And he says, if you look at this whole chapter, wonderful chapter, he says, brothers and sisters, if somebody is caught in a sin, listen, you who are what? Spiritual. Should what? Restore him gently. In other words, recognize that all of us are sinners. And that if we want God to restore us to him when we sin, we've got to learn how to restore others when they sin. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Don't expect God to forgive you and you holding a grudge against your neighbor for 50 years. Let it go. Says that if you want to do good, bear one another's burdens. Bear one another, in other words, help somebody. Don't live your life just concerned about me, myself, and I, and doing for yourself and talking about how you've been blessed without being a blessing to somebody else, like Brother and Sister Burrell were last night. You got to take your blessings and ask yourself, if the Lord has given me this, has he given it to me to spend only on myself, or has he given it to me to help somebody? Because somewhere along the line, somebody helped you, and somebody prayed for you, and somebody gave you a break, and you got to turn around and help somebody else. Right. First thing I did as a pastor 37 years ago in my church at Union, my first project was to pave the parking lot. It was a dirt lot. Actually, where the new sanctuary is now, those of you who've been there, was a dirt lot. First thing I did was say, we got to pave this lot. You know, women were walking out in the rain and all that kind of stuff, so we're going to pave the lot, and we put on a campaign that cost, you believe it, back then, $2,000. I was so happy. I was proud. We raised, took us 3 months, raised $2,000. And do you know that a lady came to me and said, I'm not giving to pay no lot because I ain't got no car. And you laugh, but there are a lot of folk like that. If it doesn't benefit them, they ain't gonna help. I'm not giving on no lot because I ain't got no car. You got to help somebody else. You got to give for scholarships even if your children ain't in college. You got to help somebody else. You can't just do stuff when your children are benefiting but not do it when they're not benefiting. You got to help everybody. You got to be consistent in your walk with God. You've got to do good, not sometime, but every opportunity. And then he goes on to say, while you're doing all this good, don't be too high and lift it up. You know, some folk, I think, do good because they want to feel superior to the folk they doing good for. He says, if anybody thinks he's something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. Don't think that just because you're doing good to somebody that you're better than they are. And he says, goes on to say, don't compare yourself with somebody else. Lord have mercy. Don't put yourself up against some. Don't compare yourself with somebody else, because comparisons lead to envy. And comparisons lead to jealousy. And you can be so miserable thinking about what somebody else has because somebody else seems to have more than you have. But you don't know what misery that stuff has caused them. You don't know what's going on when their front door is closed. You don't know what's going on in their house. Thank God for who you are and for what you got, and use it to God's glory. And then he says, if you want to do good, you got to be a blessing and share good things with those who instruct us in God's word. That's the preacher. Y'all need to do good to me. That's what it says. I didn't make that up. I thought I would throw that in, though. I wasn't going to skip over that, because it's in the text. Y'all treat me right. That's what it says. And then these familiar words, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. If you sow seeds to please the sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. If you sow seeds to please the spirit, you will reap eternal life. In other words, what goes around is coming around. And the seeds that you sow are coming back to you. And even if they don't come back in your lifetime, God can bless your grandchildren because of what you do. You can't tell me I'm not living on my grandmother's blessings and on my grandmother's goodness. Bessie Finch lived a Christian life, and her grandson is reaping the blessings from a grandmother who prayed, and a mama and a daddy. I'm blessed because of them. So every now and then I'm somewhere and somebody say, you a Mapson's boy? I say, yes, I am. Then the problem with doing good, and I'm through in a minute, is that you can get tired of doing good. There is a weariness that can set in. Now, not tired of it, but tired in it. There's a difference here. Not tired of it, but getting tired in it. You don't get tired of raising your children, but you sure enough can get tired in it. In the process of raising your, you don't get tired and weary of your marriage, I hope. But you can sure enough get tired in it, in the process of relating one to another. You can get tired and weary, listen, of serving the Lord. You can get tired and weary in church stuff. Doing good can wear you down. Can I work this out a little bit this morning? Especially when you don't always see the results of doing good. When you're doing good and I'm just doing good, but I can't see the results. When you do good, but the good you do seems unappreciated. Anybody here? When you do good, but the good you do is misunderstood, and you do good, but somebody gets in there and twists your motives and puts some poison in somebody's head, and everything you tried to do that was good is thrown back in your... Anybody here? And when you do good, but the person for whom you are doing good seems to be so ungrateful. Because some folk act like that's what you just supposed to do for me. Am I right about that? Just as ungrateful and ain't gonna never do nothing for you, but always got the hand out, always wanting you to do something for them. Unjust as ungrateful, and you know they go around acting like that's what you supposed to do. No, I ain't supposed to do nothing. Just as ungrateful, they take your goodness and never say thank you. They take your money and never pay it back. Anybody here today? They take your kindness and never show any gratitude. And sometimes you get weary. But let me tell you something. If that's the way they treat you, that's also the way they treat the Lord. Because a whole lot of folk take from God and never get down on their knees and thank Him. A whole lot of folks stayed home this morning because of a few raindrops and didn't remember who woke them up this morning. They wouldn't have been able even to roll over in the bed unless God was with them. Some folk are in the hospital right now, got to call a nurse to help them roll over. So don't feel so bad. If they that way with you, they that way with the Lord too. You remember those lepers, those 10 lepers, and 9 of those brothers never came back to say thank you. Only a Samaritan, a nobody, a person low on the socioeconomic ladder, which means that you can be healed in body and still be thankless. Your body can be made whole, but your heart can remain ungrateful. You can be healthy and still a sorry individual. As I wrap up this today, does my goodness count for anything? Does anybody see it? Well, let me tell you something. Don't worry about that. Make sure he sees it. Make sure he knows. Because the well done ain't coming from down here. The well done is coming from up there. And if when you give the best of your service, telling the world that the Savior has come, be not dismayed when men don't believe you. He'll understand. Not the pastor, not the deacon, not your husband, not your wife, not your children, but the Lord will say, well done. I'm feeling good right now. But I tell you, my brothers and sisters, you want to know how long? I'm here to tell you, I don't know how long. I'm tired, Lord. How long? I'm getting weary, Lord. How long? I feel like giving up, but how long? Sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain. But then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. When you're weary, don't quit. When you feel like giving up, don't quit. When you wonder how long, don't quit. When you bear your burdens in the heat of the day, don't quit. When you can't see the results, don't quit. When you're discouraged,
Don't quit when you feel all alone. Don't quit. There's a bright side somewhere. Hold on. Trouble don't last always. Hold on. Joy is coming in the morning. Hold on. The battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. Hold on. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Hold on. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on.
Door of the church is open. Just hold on a little while longer and be not weary in well doing. This whole part that I didn't even get to. In due season.
All right.
At the proper time, we will reap. If we in due season. Now, you got to remember that your season ain't God's season. Because if it was up to you, due season would be this afternoon.
That's it. That's it.
If it were up to me, due season would be at 3 o'clock. But in God's season, it may be tomorrow, I don't know. It may be next week, it may be next year, it may be 10 years from now. It may never be, but as long as I hold on to God's unchanging hand. And then Paul says to do good, especially to those who belong to the family of God. In other words, you're supposed to do good for everybody, but we need to understand we are special people. We are special people, and we are called upon to especially do good to those who belong to the family of God. Door of the church is open today. And there may be somebody here, you've been searching for a long time, you've been doing good, trying to do good, and you have nothing to sustain you. Well, you can't just do it by yourself. You have to trust God to sustain you and to give you strength and to do good for the right reason. When you do that, I don't care what folk do. I don't care what folk say. You can hold out because your well done is coming from above. Won't you come today if you're here and you're outside of the ark of safety? The door of the church is open and you need to come now, for tomorrow is not promised. For the Lord wants to get in your life and make you a new creature. Won't you come now?
Help me to hold out.
Won't you come?
Lord,
help me, help me.
Help me to hold out.
Won't you come?
Oh.
may not be easy.
Everybody.
You did not say that it would be. But if it can start, can't see my way. You told me to put my trust in me. That's why I'm asking. Oh, why don't you help me to hold?